Cool. Hi, everyone. My name's Lauren Jones. I'm a PhD student at Lincoln University, but what I'm presenting today is actually some of my master's work that I published in 2021. So today I'm going to be talking about the impact of post-harvest residue on tall fescue seed production. So tall fescues are perennial seed crops. So a benefit to this is you can get multiple harvests out of the same crop. So it's economically beneficial because you're not having to reed your new crop every season. But one limitation to tall fescue is that it produces a massive amount of residue, and this needs managed. So this picture here shows the crop just before we harvested it in our trial, and it actually had 9 tonnes of biomass at that point. So there's 3 types of management that are most commonly used. So this is cutting and baling, or we have grazing, or there's also burning. But these days, burning's a lot less commonly used due to concerns around air quality and the fact you need consent to burn in a lot of different places. So post-harvest, the straw, which is the residue from the previous season, is then baled or finely chopped. So for our trial, we finely chopped it and spread it around the crop. So that's what you can see here in this picture. So the residue, which is what we're calling this vegetative matter that's still left, is then left to regrow up until closing. So closing happens in June. So we actually close the crop around the 12th of June. And the residue needs to be managed up until then. So the issue with tall fescue is that each tiller needs to actually be individually vernalised. So this means up to closing, your tillers then need to have enough time to be able to grow and be vernalised to be able to go reproductive the following season. Any spring tillers you get won't actually be vernalised and won't produce a seed head. So the aim of our work was to test the effects of autumn defoliation height and frequency on post-harvest residue of a tall fescue seed crop. So this picture here is actually what the trial looked like. So these fenced off areas are our 4 different reps. So the trial site was located on Simon Lockhead's property in Bar Hill. So Bar Hill's near Rakaia. And the cultivar we used was called Volupta. So Volupta is a continental tall fescue cultivar. So it was grown in New Zealand as a multiplication crop and then sent back to Europe afterwards. So an issue that Simon Lockhead found was that his tall fescue seed yield declined from 1,500 kilograms to the hectare down to 600 kilograms to the hectare in his second season. So this is actually quite commonly seen in a lot of tall fescue seed crops, especially continental ones that don't get vernalised properly. So what we did is we looked at the crop in the 3rd year of production to see if we could slow that rate of decline and see if or improve the seed yield. So this was our trial design. So this is just an example of one plot. So our cutting height treatments were either mown to 14 centimetres or we mowed the crop to 7 centimetres. So 14 centimetres is normally standard of what you'd cut the crop to, and 7 centimetres we went back and mowed it shorter afterwards. So we also had cutting frequency treatments. So within each cutting height, we had 3 different cutting frequency treatments. So we cut the crop either 3 times, so this was roughly every 28 days up until closing, or we cut it once at closing, or we didn't cut it at all, just to see how the management affected the crop. So this is what the cutting heights actually looked like. So the plots cut to 14 centimetres, they have a lot of leaf tissue left, whereas the plots cut to 7 centimetres, we pretty much scalped to try and allow more light in. And as you can see in the plots cut to 7 centimetres, you can just see how dense these rows actually get and how many tillers you get within each row. But at harvest, we found the majority of the sward actually stayed vegetative. There were very few reproductive tillers, so that and this had declined from the previous season. So looking at our results, the plots cut to 14 centimetres actually had 40% higher seed yields than the plot cut to 7 centimetres. So this was actually the opposite to what we expected. We thought that by scalping the crop down to 7 centimetres, we'd allow more light in and increase your tiller number, and therefore increase your number of reproductive tillers. But in reality, the opposite actually happened. For the cutting frequency treatments, there was actually no difference between if you cut the crop 3 times or if you cut the crop once. So that means you could take multiple baleage cuts from your crop or just a single cut at closing, and it's not going to negatively impact your seed yield. But the nil cut treatments produce the lower seed yields out of any of the cutting frequency treatments. So we also measured reproductive tiller counts. So these pretty much followed the same trend, where we had 46% more reproductive tillers in the plots cut to 14 centimetres compared to the plots cut to 7 centimetres. And then once again, we had no difference whether you cut the crop once or three times, but if you didn't cut the crop at all, this did negatively impact your reproductive tiller number. So we also looked at biomass yield. So biomass yield was highest in the nil cut plots and also highest in the plots cut to 14 centimetres, so this was to be expected. But we also measured light interception. So our light interception was significantly higher in the plots cut to 14 centimetres when compared with the plots cut to 7 centimetres. But in this graph, you can see that the nil cut plots look like they have the highest light interception, but they actually didn't, because we measured it with a septometer, so just due to the way we measured it, the numbers are a lot higher, but we actually had a massive amount of leaf senescence and disease and lodging. So this would have negatively impacted the plant's actual ability to intercept this light. So if we go back to our cutting height picture, so the plots cut to 7 centimetres, all of this leaf tissue was actually removed. So we thought that this would allow more light in and increase the tiller number, but actually what it did is it depleted the plant's carbohydrate reserves. So the plants cut to 7 centimetres, every time they were cut, they had pretty much no leaf tissue left. So what this means is they're having to remobilise all of their reserves to be able to produce new leaf tissue to support photosynthesis. Whereas in the plots cut to 14 centimetres, every time they were cut, they still had enough leaf tissue that they could support their growth without having to remobilise all of their reserves. So what likely happened is that we had insufficient reserves to be able to either go reproductive or for the tillers to survive. So reproductive initiation requires a huge amount of carbohydrate reserves, but what could have also happened was that the tillers that were cut to 7 centimetres likely senesced, so then they weren't vernalised during that winter period. So the new tillers that were produced in spring, they weren't vernalised, so they didn't go reproductive, and this would have negatively impacted our seed yield. So our nil-cut treatment also would have had a similar sort of thing happen. So because there was a lot of lodging, disease, and senescence, there wasn't a lot of leaf tissue to effectively photosynthesize, and therefore you weren't supporting growth. So in conclusion, harvesting to 14 centimetre actually produced the greater seed yields. So this was the opposite to what we expected, but when you think about the plant's actual carbohydrate reserves and what it requires, this actually makes sense. The frequency of cutting wasn't actually important, as long as at least one cut is made. So this suggests you can take multiple baleage cuts to diversify your income, or you can just take one single cut. But overall, the yield still actually declined from first year regardless of our treatment. So our highest seed yield was only 450 kilograms to the hectare, which still isn't really financially viable unless you're diversifying your income through grazing store lambs or cutting and selling silage. So overall, we didn't really improve the seed yield, but we did show that different management practices will actually change your actual seed yield. And thank you everyone for listening. Yeah, so in research we found you need the crop to be vernalised for 1,412 hours. But we had a weather station in there, so we thought the crop was vernalised for about 1,660 hours. So it was effectively vernalised by the temperatures.
Have you looked if it applies to the other perennial seed crops?
No, we haven't. Pedurasin seeds actually have replicated it on a ryegrass crop, but I don't actually know what the results were yet. I just know they were replicating the same trial. No, unfortunately not. That would have been good to do, but yeah, we didn't do that. So this is, a lot of it is just we're assuming what happened. It'll be good to actually look into more of that.